Alright, so this is basically the framework of automation theory. One can do lots of algebra. For example, people have called this operator sum over I not equal to 0. Get this projection operator. Sum over I, it is called resolvent. R naught or something. Then you can write it very easily. Psi 0, 0, V, R naught, V, Psi 0, 0. So lots of nice algebra equipment. I don't want to go into that. That's a mathematician's delight. And actually, they help. So this particular operator, sum over I, not equal to 0, is called R naught. So the whole thing can be written as Psi 0, 0, V, R naught, V, Psi 0, 0. Then entire lots of things become simple. Because everywhere there is this sked bra divided by orbital energy difference, you call it R naught. So you just take it out, resolvent operator. So they are basically resolving. The top one is just projection operator. So the only difference is when I'm subtracting by this, when I'm dividing by the energy denominator, it is called resolvent. But resolvent operators also have very nice properties and so on and so forth. So anyway, the perturbation theory is a lot of mathematics. Okay? At the end, and those who are really interested have to go into this. But for the time being, I will say that this is how at least the first correlation contribution comes. And physically, it comes because of the doubly excited determinant. That because of the Coulomb correlation, as was suggested, the most dominant part of this excitation would be a doubly excited. And that's indeed true. So of course, as I said, triples, quadruples, singles will contribute, but they're at a higher order, their values are small. But I just wanted to correct that it is not strictly right to say that only doubly excited contribute to ground shedding in that sense. But only at the second order, yes. And this is the most dominant part. This actually brings, since I've already discussed this, this actually brings to a mathematically simpler method. Yeah, I'll close in another 5-10 minutes. A mathematically simpler method, which is basically an eigenvalue equation, which is known as the configuration interaction. In fact, now it's very easy to discuss this. So I don't do perturbation. I simply write my psi 0 as C naught psi r to 4. Now that I have included this term, alpha p, C alpha p, psi alpha p. And just as I said, alpha C alpha beta p q, psi alpha beta p, and so on. This is what exactly I wanted to say. That since you have all the states of H naught, these are eigenstates of H naught, all the determinant, they form a complete set. I can write my exact wave function as a linear combination of all these determinants, and then again apply variation method. So apply variation method to obtain these coefficients. So Hartree, first single determinant itself was variationally optimized to get a Hartree form. Now improvement is also done by linear variation. This is a very simple thing because the orbitals are no longer changing. Only thing that is changing is the coefficients, and this is called the linear variation method. By applying these, I will of course get improvement of energy. So this particular procedure is called the configuration interaction, and I think the physicists use this very well. Configuration, expansion, whatever you want to tell. It's a combination of different configurations. Configuration is my determinant in this case. Just to keep you updated about this. If I take all determinants in a basis, whatever my virtual basis is, then this will be full CR.
Why should it improve the answer?
Because I'm taking more number of terms. If I have only Hartree 4, whatever will be the value, if I take both terms, that's the variation.
Does the perturbation theory, you could actually see that the energy would be lower?
Yes, because it's a variation method, so energy, the upper bound principle will still be there. So the result will improve, but will never go below E naught. All right, so in fact, I teach this in a class, but it takes a couple of hours. There's a very nice theorem for the linear variation, which is called McDonald's separation. Again, those who are interested should see this. It's a physical review 1933. Physical review 1933, McDonald proved a theorem for linear variation. So if you do a mathematics of the linear variation, very simple. So if I have energy, let me try to write it down. If I have energy obtained from an m basis, from an n basis, now my basis are determinants, they will be always lower than energy obtained from an m minus 1 basis. Okay? And each of them will, of course, be higher than E naught. What was even more interesting is McDonald. What McDonald really showed, this is of course quite trivial, but what McDonald really showed is that if I have the ground state, let's say this is my E naught, this is my E1, and so on, E2, these are exact energies. If I start with an M basis, I get E0, 0, some E0M, E1M, etc., etc. Now I increase the basis state. What will happen? By this theorem, they will all go down. This will also go down. But what is interesting is that the best result of E1 will never be the worst result for E0 if I do this two basis problem, which means they will never cross the line. So they will keep on improving and yet remaining upper bound to its corresponding exact states. It's a very beautiful, elegant theorem. In fact, it is actually known as a Hume, Hilleras, Hundheim, McDonald theorem. It's a very famous theorem for linear variation. You continue to keep it upper bound, although each of the results are improving, never crossing its own line. That's a Luxburg-Weka. So if you do an infinite thing, each of them will asymptotically reach. This only happens for linear variation. You can show upper bound, but this asymptotic reaching and not crossing this line is actually very interesting for linear variation. That's actually applied for CI.
How do you say anything about E1 and E2 from linear variation?
You can now, because I can get, this actually will be obtained by an eigenvalue equation. Okay? So I will get several roots. One root will be ground state approximation, another will be first excited state. And now I can say further, each of them is an upper bound because of the McDonald theorem. So that is why CI is very powerful. When I did MP2, I showed only for ground state. There are excited state MP2, but that's far more complicated. But here you can quite clearly see, if you do solve this, you actually will get the Hamiltonian matrix elements in this basis diagonalized. I think this exercise anybody can do. It's a quantum mechanics, simple quantum mechanics, that I write sum over psi equal to sum over CI, phi I. All you know is to get Hamiltonian in the basis and diagonalize, right? So you get, as an eigenvalue equation, this, you get n roots. Now, because of the McDonald separation, I can now tell each root is an upper bound to its corresponding exact state. So that's the beauty. And I increase the basis, m to m plus 1, each one improves. But each one remains this upper bound. Okay? So those who are interested should read the physical review 1933. So McDonald actually, in fact, in the classes I actually do. So those who are coming for my class, advanced quantum mechanics, I'll actually prove this. The proof is highly complex. It's actually mathematics. Because this has nothing to do with Hamiltonian. It can be any eigenvalue problem. Please understand, it's an eigenvalue problem. So if I have any operator, eigenvalue problem, there are some rules. So McDonald actually proved it for a general eigenvalue problem where the basis is increasing. And I want to get the coefficients. So it's basically mathematics. You can see 1933 people have done. So it was very simple. It's a nice application to CI. What I wanted to mention is that if you do all configuration, then it is an exact function within this basis. That is called full CI, which physicists call exact diagonalization. Again, I want to show that the physicists call exact diagonalization. That is nothing but full CI in my terminology, full configuration expansion. Exact. That's why it's called exact. If you truncate anywhere, like if I truncate here, then this will be called CI singles doubles. For obvious reasons, you can understand now. I only have singles doubles. I can have double CI and so on. The truncation will give an approximate result, but it is pretty bad. It can be disastrous something, truncation. So again, without going into details, and that is why, because I'm not going to cover Kapler cluster, That is where coupled cluster does much better. For example, if you take a H4, separate H2 plus H2. So H4 is going to hydrogen plus hydrogen, right? What do you expect at an infinite separation? You expect psi H4 to be psi H2 into psi H2, anti-symmetric phase product. Energy, this plus this, right? That's very simple because they're non-interacting things. It's very easy to show that if you do double CI for H4, then in a regime of when this happens, you require a double CR and a double CR for the product function. Psi H2 doubles into Psi H2 doubles is contains a quadruple, just like I showed. Two pair excitations here. But if you do H4 doubles, that is missing. Unless you do H4 quadruples. So if you do consistently H4 DCI, H2 DCI, H2 DCI can be exact, then you will find that the energy of H4 or the wave function will not be a product, and energy will not be a sum. This is a very serious error, which is called size consistency error. So there is a term which is well understood now. If a theory predicts a dimer, let's say AB, EAB, as this is R, let's say, as R tends to infinity, should be EA plus EB, right? So if a theory can predict this correctly, it is called size consistent theory. However, for a DCI wave function, if I calculate EH4, EH2, H2, then this will not be twice EH2 at a non-interacting density, even at non-interacting density. So this is a serious problem because you can look at the wave function. Wave function of H4 and product of the wave function of H2, DCI. Product must contain a quadruple for H4, which is not there. And this is exactly what is done nicely in coupled cluster, because whatever is this amplitude product in coupled cluster, it is called T2. And then if I do a coupled cluster doubles, my wave function will have an exponential of this. And this exponential guarantees that although I have T2, in the final function I have T2 square, T2 cube, wherever it is required, after that it becomes zero. So that is the reason the coupled cluster, in such a case, will do it correctly. And that is the whole idea of the exponential. Remember why it is happening. A linear expansion is not factorizable. Exponential expansion is factorizable. Exponential TA plus TB is exponential TA into TB.
Does it do infinite entanglement? Because when I have together, when I take it off, should not become a product of that function. Even if I take it off due to entanglement.
No, if it is completely, there is no entanglement. If it is completely non-interactive. And one of these is this problem of H4 going to H2 plus H2. And there are several other problems. Hartree-Fock also can have some problems. Like H2, if you do RHF, does not break. This is a very, the chemists know this, that if you do a H2 potential surface, okay, and this is R, this is H plus H line. So you should normally get this. Right? But if you do Hartree-Fock for hydrogen molecule, you get something like this, and it will go like this. So even for Hartree-Fock, this is the problem. So this is the restricted Hartree-Fock, sigma g square. The molecular orbital theory, sigma g square, also has a problem because when I pull them up, they're up down, when I pull them up, they remain like this. But actually it can be like this. That's the reason energy, actual energy is lower, which it doesn't get, because I'm keeping this restricted. There the problem is because although I'm separating, the memory of restricted remains. But in actual effect, if hydrogen plus hydrogen, and that region should be just 2EH. So this happens because a closed shell system is fragmenting into two open shell systems. On the other hand, if you have H4, going to H2 plus H2, Hartree-Fock does well, because it remains closed and closed. So I may, if I have to say this, H2 going to H plus H RHF cannot do. Even RHF cannot do, restricted Hartree form. On the other hand, if H4 goes to H2 plus H2, RHF is good. Because it is close, going to close plus close. One can show this. RHF is good. But then BCI is bad. So if you have H4 going to H2 plus H2, RHF is okay. And then you do a better result with DCI that disturbs the size consistency. So better does not mean better. Right? Better means if results are good, energy was lower, but actually it is not giving the right chemistry. So what do you do? If I wanted the chemistry RHF for better for H4, H2 plus H. If you do H3 plus H, they can fragment in any channel. Again, RHF is a problem. So whenever closed shell is going to open plus open, even RHF cannot do separation. Close going to close plus close, RHF is good, but then DCI will again disturb it. So these are many, many very interesting effects that people have looked at. Again, they are very important for chemistry because you look at reaction. So if my method is not right, it will give me a channel of separation which is wrong. And that is essentially the problem that why we have to be very careful what method to use. Because very often we are fragmenting, very often we are separating bonds, breaking bonds. So if you are not interested in this region, then it's okay. But the chemists have to worry about it. And that sometimes again is a small distinction between the problems of chemistry and physics. Because these kind of size separation is a very important part of chemistry. Otherwise my reaction that I will predict is wrong.
Yeah, so basically saying that I have to forget the memory that I was together. Somehow that memory is to be undone. Which in the quantum language I would say is entanglement.
Yeah, you can say.
Undo the entanglement, yeah. And then I have to get to the right side.
You can say, but this memory has to completely go.
Completely go.
But it doesn't go if I have RHA. I'm always putting one alpha, one beta. So, because my wave function remains RHF even at this distance. If you do UHF, it will go. Because UHF wave function did not have this baggage that this has to be alpha, this has to be beta. So they will move variationally, they will separate flexibility, and they will do the right result. So RHF is bad, but as soon as you do UHF, it gives correct result. So this is my UHF for the same H2 problem. But I told you, VHF is not spin adapted. I already told you, because it may not be chi sigma g alpha, sigma g beta. It can be sigma g alpha, yeah. Sigma g alpha, some other sigma g prime beta. And then it is no longer spin adapted. So again, that's the question, what do you want? If you want a spin adapted state, then RHF itself doesn't separate. So you have to see how to separate these by a clever CI calculation. A clever CI calculation will do, but we have to know how to do it. Yes?
Yeah, so it's actually the same point, the let's say this unrestricted Hartree form that you spoke about last time. So that breaks the spin rotational symmetry,
right,
one
right,
that
right,
you
right,
said.
Right.
So I want to understand what is meant by getting better, because if you construct
lower
energy,
yeah,
in CI with UHF, that broken spin rotational symmetry is never going to be restored.
No.
Right? So is that better?
No, that's what I'm saying. Better is not necessarily better. Depends on what you want. When I mean
that
better.
What does Hamiltonian want?
No, when I mean that better, the energy is lower.
Well, that's a limited.
Yeah. But your spin may not be right. So you're absolutely right. But